Dr. Walter, according to the first line in your autobiography, Theme and Variations, you arrived in this world on September 15th, 1876. Do you have any recollection of the arrival?
No, not a clear recollection, no. I suppose I behaved badly.
Well, in the 63 years that you've been conducting,
yes,
I imagine that it must all now seem like just one wave of the baton.
Well, yes, it gets blurred.
It's in retrospect.
Yes, it is so, yes. But I did something else besides conducting, of course. I learned something and I traveled and I wrote something, so my life has not been concentrated on conducting.
No, but it's particularly significant that as you approach your 80th birthday, that you do live in this era, the electronic age. If you had lived a few generations back, we wouldn't have the benefit of the many recordings that you've conducted.
I am really very happy about this idea that the disappearance of all the traces of our lives as performing musicians is not anymore to be feared, that we really, in some sense, can live on with our best efforts. Imagine it began with the records of Caruso, for instance, which have preserved the beauty of his voice.
Yes.
For the coming singers who can study his voice production and see how he sang on this vowel and attacked this phrase, where he took his breath and all these things. So it's a kind of school even.
Yes.
And so it is for young conductors who can see how Toscanini conducted this or that.
And Bruno Walter.
Well, and perhaps also something which I did, so, yes.
Well, it has a great educational value, of
course.
Yes,
it has, yes.
And I think that perhaps the future of the recording industry contains even a greater contribution to our cultural enjoyment. Or do you think I'm too optimistic, Doctor?
I am optimistic. I'm born optimistic, and I explained once that I am optimistic as a musician because all music is striving for consonance, except the atonal music.
Yes.
So it's consonance. All the dissonances in music go to consonances, and the sense of a dissonance is to be solved into consonance. So that's the optimism of the musician who follows just the law of his art. You know?
Well,
so
again, as you say, all of your life you've dedicated yourself to bringing out the harmony of sound.
Beauty of sound.
Let's say beauty of sound, beauty as of expressed sound. By harmony
yes,
of sound.
Yeah.
In connection with your 63 years of conducting and the fact that this span of yours has been identified, particularly during these later years, with the recording industry, do you have any definite recollections about the first recorded performance you conducted?
And very vivid recollection. We sat like in animal cages. I was very highly posted and the orchestra around me, far below me the tuba and the brass, and on my sides the strings, and there was no double bass allowed to play without being supported by the bass tuba, otherwise the low tones could not be recorded. And the outcome was not so very enjoyable.
Do you remember the specific work that you conducted at your first session?
Oh, I think it was an Antrag from Carmen. Three Antrags of Carmen, yes.
Well,
the Berlin Philharmonic Orchestra.
This was quite some time before your identification
my
with
heaven,
Mozart.
Oh, God, how long ago it is. I think it was in 1900. Very simple. In Berlin, yes. I was at the opera, at the Royal Opera conductor, you know, at this time, together with Richard Strauss and Karl Muck. We were the three conductors. And I was in the tender age of 24. And then I had conducted concerts already and was invited to conduct, to make records.
Well, your recording session in 1900 was not part of a series, I imagine. I guess
it was not a part of a series, but several. Oh,
did
yes.
you do many
oh,
of them?
Yeah. Oh, yes. That's several. Oh, yes. It was not such an exceptional event. No, no.
When do you recall having first conducted the composers with which you are most identified now, like Brahms, Mozart,
from
Beethoven, Schubert? Almost from the beginning?
Yes. I conducted, let me say, in Hamburg in the year 1894. I conducted the Walküre of Wagner. And Aida I conducted.
Well, Doctor, do you remember the first time that you conducted Mahler or Bruckner?
Bruckner, much later. I was nearly 40 when I conducted Bruckner. Mahler I conducted as, let me see, I was together with him in Hamburg. Mahler fell ill Walküre was given. So I jumped in and conducted it. Yes. And then I began in Hamburg as a coach. Mm-hmm. 2 weeks later, I was chorus director. And some weeks later, I was already entrusted with conducting operas. Let me see, what did I conduct? I think Carmen.
This was while Mahler was there.
Mahler was
there.
He was there. He took care of that. It was in the second year in Hamburg, 1895. I was 19 years old. I was conductor.
Yes.
In Hamburg and conducted whatever was there.
The whole repertoire.
Oh, everything. I conducted Fra Diavolo and Lucia and Aida and Ballo in Maschera and whatever was there.
Well, of course, Mahler, as I recall, was taken with you at that
point.
Oh,
yes,
and then
very
he
much
moved.
So.
When did he move to Vienna?
He moved to Vienna 1 year after I moved off Hamburg. He came to Vienna 1897. I left Hamburg 96.
Yes.
And went to Breslau. And in Breslau I had my first performance of Magic Flute. That's 60 years ago.
Well, that's a great deal of history has been made since the first time you conducted the Magic Flute.
A great deal of history, and particularly it is a development in the love for Mozart. When I was a young conductor, the musicians all loved and wanted to do it, but the directions of the operas, the managements, were very much against. It was no box office. And for instance, in Riga, I remember very well that one of the board, when he found out that the box office was not so very brilliant, he said, we must give better pieces to the director. So this was related to me.
A challenge.
And then, through Mahler's efforts in Vienna, Mozart was seen in a new aspect. His dramatic veracity was acknowledged, and Mozart became a box office. And later on, I continued this line in Munich. I was 10 years in Munich. And of course, I served the cause of Mozart very much in Munich. I had the Residenztheater, you know,
yes,
this wonderful little theater. And I had the big opera, the Nationaltheater, and the Prinzregententheater. I had 3 theaters in Munich. Of course, I did not give the Magic Flute in the Prinzregententheater, but I did give it both in the Residenztheater and in the Nationaltheater. And Mozart became one of the great draw cards of the opera in Berlin when I came there. And then later I once came to Vienna and took up the... I was the director of the Vienna Opera 35 until 38 until our Hitler came. And then, of course,
that
was
went
off.
Yes.
But then, until this time, Mozart had become a real box office, more than Verdi, more than Wagner.
Yes.
And here I conducted Magic Flute, I think 5 years ago, or I don't remember. Was it in the 40s or was it the 50s?
It was in the 40s.
In the 40s,
late 40s,
conducted
I
late 40s.
Yes.
I conducted it here. Yes.
Well, I know that in spite of so many people closely identifying you with Mozart, of course your performances of Beethoven, Brahms, and naturally Bruckner and Mahler stand as the definitive performances in the opinion of so many people. But I have noticed personally, every time you and I talk, that when you speak of Mozart, you always say that you have been able to serve the cause of Mozart.
Yes.
And I'm interested in that, Doctor, the fact that you consider Mozart a cause. Yes. Could you tell me why specifically?
I serve the cause. I dare say I have no favorite composer. I have a very wide heart. So you know the last word of Kundry, mm-hmm, the only word which he says in the whole third act of Parsifal is dienen, dienen. It is in German for serve. Of course, I love particularly to serve the cause of Mozart, and it's near to my heart, no doubt. Since I can think back, my love for Mozart has grown.
Well, in the early days of your studies, as I recall, you stated that you were so taken with Wagner.
Yes.
And Mozart seemed a little remote at the time,
it's right,
to you.
Yes, that was when I was very young, before when I was a teenager. Then I only was enthusiastic for the great pathos and the big emotions. And Mozart seemed to me at this time too quiet, too tranquil. It needs some maturity to understand the depth of emotion which speaks in Mozart's seeming tranquility and measure. Youth is much more apt to love the shout and the great gestures and so on. That's, I fell into the same category.
When did you first begin conducting the symphonic works of Mozart?
I conducted very early the E-flat major symphony and the C major, the Jupiter.
The Jupiter.
Very immature, and I'm sure it was absolutely not good, but very late, the G minor. I was, I think, 50 years when I first time was audacious enough to perform the G minor. I was so, had such a feeling of responsibility and of the difficulty to perform it that I could not make up my mind until I was, I think it was nearly that I was 50 years old when I made my first performance of the G minor. And I wondered at all the young conductors who without any qualms just went ahead and conducted all these works which ask for such depth of feeling and such maturity of technique.
No question about it. When, do you recall, was your first performance of the Requiem?
Requiem, Vienna.
Do you remember the year?
It must have been in 1901 or 1902. I had a chorus. I had the famous Vienna Singing Academy. My predecessor was Johannes Brahms. So I couldn't choose a greater one, a more embarrassing one. But after Brahms, of course, there was Gericke and there were other conductors who had the leadership of the Singing Academy. But anyhow, the Singing Academy, when I was a young conductor, fell into my hands, and there I performed my, I think it was my first performance of the Mozart Requiem. It was 1901 or 2.
Well, what?
Well, 3, I don't know.
In comparison, it would be interesting to hear the differences of your impressions of the first performance of the Requiem you conducted, measured against the performance that you have conducted this year and which is now to be released on Columbia Records.
I hope this last one is a little more mature. And, of course, I also took more liberty with Sussmayer's treatment of the Mozart score, because Sussmayer had a very routine way of handling the instrumentation. He wrote, the first trombone goes with the contralto of the chorus, second trombone with the tenor, and bass trombone with the bass. And they had to play through the whole work in this way. So, of course, I had not so much respect for Sussmayer, although he is an excellent musician, but not a had not a great knowledge of orchestra. So I alleviated a little this heavy weight of the trombones throughout the...
In this recent performance of yours?
Yes, already in preceding ones, in London last year. I performed it in London last year, for instance. I also there did not use the trombones all the way because it has a terribly tiring effect on the ear and it is not has not the authority of Mozart behind this use of the trombones.
Well, you must have always been conscious of the intrusion of Sussmayer.
Of course, I am very much conscious of it, and I study it very carefully to find out what he had done. And I must say, I have great respect for him as a musician in the composition of the Benedictus, which there's not one note of Mozart in the manuscript. I am sure Mozart has played it for him, sung it for him, had spoken about it to him, and Sussmayer from memory has then reconstructed, or constructed, we can say,
the
Benedictus, also the rest of the Lacrimosa. Of the Lacrimosa, we have only 8 bars from Mozart's hand. And of course, we have very little instrumented parts of the Requiem. The first piece is entirely Mozart, so is the Dies Irae. But from the Tuba Mirum on, things become a little enigmatic. There still are parts where we are sure this is Mozart, but very many parts of which we are not sure. And then we have just to guess. And because I believe to know Mozart rather well, I believe I could guess where Sussmayer took liberties or where he only followed Mozart's wishes.
Yes.
And so, and of course, my performance followed these ideas which I had of where Mozart finished and Sussmayer began.
Well, Doctor, so many people consider the Requiem to be Mozart's final testament, his final artistic testament. But I note that you consider the magic flute to be his spiritual testament.
Yeah.
And I would be interested, and I know that your many friends and admirers would be interested in knowing why you so deem the magic flute to be his spiritual testament.
You have only to follow the words which Sarastro sings in the last aria, his behavior to those who sin against him. His first Pamina, who ran away, has flown from his power. How he answers her confession of guilt. What he tells Pamina after he has got the dagger from her mother to murder Sarastro, that he speaks with, that he does not know of revenge. And in these holy portals, forgiveness is given. This is, in my mind, the spiritual testament of Mozart, it was his own confession, and he created Sarastro. We shall never forget that Sarastro was, by Schikaneder, meant as a villain, as an evil villain, who robbed the queen, the mother, of her daughter. Mozart changed the whole figure and brought confusion into the whole plot by that, because Schikaneder was not able or didn't want to change accordingly the whole other plot. So he put a pious and lofty Sarastro in the middle of a play where he was thought originally as a villain. But Mozart just wanted to put into Sarastro his last with will, as I say.
Well, it was even more autobiographical than that in the other characters. The differences of Tamino as against Papageno.
Oh, yes. These are, in my mind, the two sides of Mozart's character. He was Tamino, who strove for the highest development of his capacities, his soul's and mind's capacities. At the same time, he was Papageno, who loved good food and good drink and girls. So, like in Faust's two souls, there lived two souls in Mozart.
Well, it's the duality of that exists in each of us, and he was able to mirror it in the magic flute, wasn't he?
That's right. And so I think that in Sarastro's words and in the immeasurably high meaning which his music gave to these words, if you would speak them, you would be impressed, but you could not go and keep it for a lifetime in your heart. But with the music of Mozart, which of course has been inspired by the idea which Sarastro expresses in words, in this music it will remain in you for your whole life, the meaning. And this is the reason that I think it is the spiritual testament and last will of Mozart. The Requiem, there he wrote his last music. This has not the sense of a testament or will, but it has a quite incomparable height of musical transfiguration.
Yes.
It is transfigured work. There are also transfigured parts in the magic flute, and very interestingly, not only in Tamino's and in Sarastro's words and music, even when Papageno expresses his longing for the girl.
Yes.
This is transfigured. You know, he is Eros. Eros himself who speaks. Mozart had already on a previous occasion expressed this mythological meaning of Eros in Cherubin.
Yes, in Cherubino,
in Nozze di Figaro. Here is the love of youth who is still cannot understand what's going on in the heart, but is only emotionally upset and not knowing what to do, what to think of himself, and so on. Here Mozart found the most astonishing musical expression for this wonderfully emotional upheaval in the young heart.
Yes.
You know? And on a higher level, much higher still, musically higher level, is the song of Papageno, Ein Mädchen oder Weibchen.
Ein Mädchen oder Weibchen.
A sweetheart or a maiden, as we say in any way. With the Glockenspiel, you
yes.
know. This is something who really understands it and listens to it, cannot keep back the tears.
Yes.
Because it is all human. Mm. You know, it is true for every human being who has a heart.
Of course, yeah. Of course. Yeah. Well, Doctor, the personality of Mozart seems to be far more obscured to us than the personalities of composers like Beethoven and Wagner. And you've indicated that in their writings they have given us an idea of their personality and personal lives. In Mozart, we have to find it more in his music.
No, we have one letter where he tells his father of death, that he thinks every day of death.
Yes.
He never goes to bed without thinking perhaps he is not anymore in this world next morning. And he not only does not feel sorrow or pains in this idea, on the contrary, he uses a very high German word, Glückseligkeit, which means in English beatitude.
Mm-hmm.
So he feels beatitude in the thought of death. Now this is such a look into Mozart's soul. We could not have a clearer look and more convincing one in his music than we have in this letter. And there is another example in Mozart's life where he behaved with a maturity which was far above his age. When his mother had died, he wrote his father that she was very ill. And he wrote a friend of the family, an abbe, Bullinger, who was a friend of the family, and said, "This has happened, my mother has died. You are my friend, and do everything you can to tell it to my father gradually, prepare him that he is not too much shocked." So he behaved, and he said, I am fully consoled with the idea that she had to leave this world. And it's a wonderful letter and a wonderful look into his soul, but of course cannot be compared to this letter of which I spoke before, where he explains his nearness to death, his friendship with death.
But it's interesting that he expresses his nearness to death and at the same time expresses his nearness to God.
That's the same. It is the same. That is the door to eternity and to what is behind eternity. Death is our door. Yes.
Dr. Walter, your adventures into the world of Mahler and Bruckner have certainly established you as the prime ambassador of their works. Would you tell me what your early responses were to both Mahler and Bruckner?
I always loved Bruckner, but I never could quite understand the vast form in which he expressed himself. I always found him loquacious, and I could not understand that his wonderful thematic substance, which was at his beck and call, yet was full
unlimited
of music,
resources.
An unlimited resource, that he had not found a more formal perfection to make a symphony out of it. Then one day I fell ill, and I had pneumonia. And it was here in America, it was in San Francisco. And without knowing that I had pneumonia, I traveled back on the boat and went to Munich. And in Munich, I felt terribly. I lied down, and there came the physician and said, "Well, I don't wonder that you feel badly. You have a double-sided pneumonia." So I was very ill. Mm. Became digitalis and all these kind of things. And after this, I understood.
That was your daughter, Bruckner.
That's my daughter, Bruckner. Yes.
Well, Doctor, would you say that Mahler in any way was a bridge for you to Bruckner?
On the contrary.
The other way around?
Other way around.
Well, isn't that interesting? Because Mahler, as I recall, was a student of Bruckner, wasn't he?
Yes. Well, I tell you, Bruckner was a very funny kind of teacher. He was more friend, and he talked, you know, and went to beer. And he was very anxious to hear everything that these kind of pupils, like Gustav Mahler, or Klose, you know, the composer,
yes,
Klose, and all these other pupils had to tell him, because he was not very cultured. He was not well read. You know, he was a primitive man with a great inner wisdom, but he had not the world at his disposal. He did not know the teachings of great philosophers. So he was a naive and primitive person. And these men who surrounded him, they were enormously well read, and he had drank the cups of wisdom from the real sources. So he learned from his students very much. Of course, they learned from his mastery, and so it was a give and take between them. But Mahler, one of the first things which Mahler told me was how much he felt he had learned from Bruckner, not from the teacher, but from the composer,
yes.
How much he felt he owed to him. And when he wrote his second symphony, there you feel influence of Bruckner. Later on, this influence is not anymore to be found.
Well, Mahler's own musical personality then began to assert itself.
Oh, much earlier. Mahler's first compositions were of the astonishing originality, and the influence of Bruckner came a little later. Perhaps you feel Bruckner's influence only from the second symphony on. No influence to be felt in the first symphony.
You don't feel
none,
any of that
oh,
first.
No, none. And no influence felt in the songs and in the vocal music which Mahler wrote preceding that. Das klagende Lied, for instance. One of his greatest first compositions. So great choral work.
Yes.
There's no Bruckner to be felt in.
Do
no
you
influence.
Feel any of it in the Kindertotenlieder?
No. Not anymore. The Kindertotenlieder belong already to the world in which he created this Lieder von der Erde, and the Ninth Symphony, which in my mind is his most important work.
Do you feel that's his testament?
It is. There's no doubt in me.
And, Doctor, about the Te Deum of Bruckner, I'd be interested in hearing your feeling about the Te Deum, what it conveys to you.
Oh. The Te Deum Laudamus, to say what the birds sing every morning, you know? He just praises God, and that's it. And within the fervor of a real religious man, he sings the hymn to praise God. It's so genuine and musically so rich. At the same time, it's very Catholic. You know, it perfectly fits into the Catholic church. You can, if you perform it there, you would feel it's in its home.
It's a part of the service.
It's part of the service. But at the same time, it's a very personal manifestation.
Well, apparently the lack of literary culture in Bruckner was more than compensated for by his ability to express himself in musical terms.
I could say only in American slang and how.
Yeah. Well, what do you feel binds Mahler and Bruckner together?
It's not so easy to say what they are.
But essentially, Doctor, at the base.
Essentially is their direction to the questions of personal religious convictions. Both are, Mahler was, his whole life through, was seeking God. Bruckner had found God.
Isn't that?
And there is the difference and the connection, you know?
Yes.
Because Bruckner was in knowledge as somebody who is so sure, he had, there was no problem for Bruckner. For Mahler, God was his whole life, the one dominating problem. And each work of Mahler was he tried to find a new musical expression for a new way to God.
And if I may ask, the influence of both Mahler and Bruckner upon you, how do you differentiate between the influence of each upon your own development?
Well, I must say that I could not think my life without Mahler and Bruckner, and I live with them. And of course, you know what it meant to me when I was 18 years old boy, to have met Mahler in person, and now really since then, until Mahler's death, had his friendship and came very near to him personally, as near as this difference of age made possible.
Yes, of course.
And this is the great difference. Mahler was a personal friend at the same time, and preceptor and model, you know. Bruckner was a great composer whose works I studied, whom I never had the happiness to meet. But I met very many people who had met Bruckner, and they conveyed to me their impressions. So later on it was to me like I had known him personally, yet there is the big difference.
Yes.
And of course, the romantic, demonic side of Mahler's being was very near to me. And Mahler's, don't forget, Bruckner was no performing musician.
No, that's right. He merely
but was Mahler was a performing musician, the greatest which I ever met, without any exception. So you can imagine what an influence this was on me as a performing musician, to have this model before my eyes.
Well, I would imagine particularly in Mozart, since he apparently...
Oh, in Wagner, my first performance in Vienna, in Hamburg, was Götterdämmerung. It was Tristan and Isolde, and this was an enormous impression for me, decisive for my whole life. Oh, yeah, it was something unforgettable, indescribable.
Well, Doctor, I'd like to ask you, speaking of conductors, like Mahler and yourself, do you think a conductor is born, or is he made?
He must be born, and after a conductor is born, he has now to be made, and make himself, and be made by favorable circumstances, by his teachers, by his impressions from other conductors. And only if you are really full of music, if you have the power to convey the meaning of what you feel to other people, not by word, even not by gestures, just by the occult force which every great artist must have in himself, can the feeling of the conductor, his reading, his meaning of music, be transferred to the musicians and through the musicians to the listener.
And that's wholly a spiritual quality of inspiration.
It is wholly a spiritual happening.
Well, did you draw upon Mahler's impressions of Mozart in his orchestral works? Did that inspire you?
No, I think I even never heard a purely orchestral work of Mozart by Mahler, but I heard his operas. I heard the Seraglio, Notte di Figaro, Don Giovanni, the Magic Flute, Così fa tutte. I heard all this from Mahler and admired it enormously.
But in the purely orchestral works, it's been your own adventure.
I think so. I cannot remember having heard one of the orchestral works of Mozart. I cannot remember. No, I don't think I heard.
Well, in the performance of the Brahms symphonies and the memorable album that was released where you conducted the four Brahms symphonies, here again was the case of a composer whom you had not met.
Yes, that's true. But I knew him even better than I knew Bruckner, because I met people who had known him very well. And of course, there are biographies, and his work has more variety insofar as there are the Lieder, which I accompanied as a boy already with the singers, you know. Yeah. There's the chamber music, which I played with all my friends. Mm-hmm. There are the sonatas, there are the quartets, sextets. And so I had so many channels through which I found my way to Brahms, you know. And then the numerous anecdotes of his life in Vienna, you know, of his funny sayings and his meetings, very few meetings with Bruckner, and so on. So I think I knew him, I know him quite well.
Yes. Well, of course, then the Requiem of Brahms.
This is one of my greatest loves in music, the Requiem of Brahms, Deutsche Requiem. It's one of, there you see, this gave me a perfectly new look into Brahms' soul, because you can hardly find in him a tendency to express himself in religious questions. But the Requiem, there he chose his own words. He took the Bible and from Isaiah to Revelations, and he chose words which were very dear to his heart, and he found the most astonishingly convincing expression. So I really, it is for me, it's one of the most sublime works which we have. So I want to say I can identify myself with this work, with the Requiem of Brahms.
Yes.
And there is another work of Mozart, of which I want to say one word. This is the Maurerische Trauermusik. The Maurerische Trauermusik is best translated in Masonic Dirge. And this is a composition, it has a duration of 7 or 8 minutes, incredibly different from anything else but Mozart wrote.
Well, it's interesting that performance is on the same recording as your Eine kleine Nachtmusik.
It is, yeah.
And it would be hard to find two greater diametrics.
You could not find greater diametrics. You could not.
Well, one of your most popular recordings of Eine kleine Nachtmusik was made, I believe, in England with the British Symphony Orchestra many years ago.
Oh, many years ago.
Do you have any recollections of it?
No, I cannot remember it. But this I did also in Berlin already in the old times. I think it must be terrible.
And you did it with Vienna, too.
And I did it with the Vienna Philharmonic. Oh, yes, oh, yes.
But your most memorable performance is the current issue, which you made with the Columbia Symphony.
It is a very good one. Yes, it's good. Yeah, I'm very, very content, very much satisfied.
I was thinking particularly about the performance of the Linz Symphony of Mozart, and the fact that the recording that was issued was really an historic recording, and the fact that it had the entire rehearsal recorded, which I believe you were unaware of at the time.
You speak of the ambush.
It really was an ambush.
Which was late for me. Yes. And I would have known the ambush, I would have avoided it. But I did not. So I was just surprised. And in the first moment, not pleasantly surprised. But then I heard it. And I only can say I approve it with all my heart. It is a quite unique look into the workshop. I am not in favor of looks into a workshop at the open rehearsals of symphonic concerts where the public can listen what we say to the orchestra.
Yes.
And how they behave. I do not appreciate it. On the contrary, I am very much against it. But in this case, I feel for young conductor, it gives really an idea how to deal with an orchestra at the first rehearsal, how to gradually impress on the orchestra what you want, and then you hear the final result and see how it was done and the outcome of it. And this, I think, this has a really an educational value, an earnest one.
Well, it certainly has a great contribution to future conductors.
I think it's good. Yes. So I am quite satisfied.
Well, Doctor, in this span of 63 years of conducting and 80 years of living, I know how rich your collection of reminiscences are. And I know that as a performing artist and a friend, the late Kathleen Ferrier was very close to you. When did you first meet her, Doctor?
It was in London. I think it was in 47 or 48 I conducted the first Edinburgh Festival. Festival in Scotland, and I wanted to do the Lied von der Erde of Mahler, but I said I could only do it if I would find a singer who could really live up to the demands, the very unusual demands of the work. And I was told there was a young English singer who made quite a great impression on all people if I would listen to her. And she came and sang for me, and she began to sing with the Sapphische Oder of Brahms. And I said, you are engaged, because it was of such rare beauty, beauty of expression, beauty of voice, and purity, and beauty of personality. It's one of my greatest impressions in my life. And since then, we became very great friends, and she sang this work with me. I engaged her for New York. She sang this Lied von der Erde with me in New York. And she was, after Lotte Lehmann, the only one which I accompanied on the piano. Then we recorded this Lied von der Erde with the Vienna Philharmonic in Vienna. And it was unforgettable when how this very beautiful girl stood on my side, already in the throes of a most terrible disease. And it was the last time I saw her.
But what a blessing that she lived in the age of recording, so that we've been able to perpetuate these performances.
What I feel. She is there in these things. And of course, you know very well the Kindertotenlieder,
yes,
which she also sang, which in my mind is a unique performance of a singer.
I know that experience was one of the many unforgettable memories you have of Vienna. But you know, speaking of Vienna, it occurs to me that not many people are aware of your love for the music of Johann Strauss, which, more than any other music, seems to embody the spirit and tradition of Vienna.
Well, you may perhaps know from my autobiography how much my contact with Vienna has meant to me.
Yes,
and if you think of Vienna, you must think of the composers who lived there, and like Mozart, like Schubert, like Johann Strauss. And it would be wrong to put Johann Strauss on a so very much lower level than the great composers which I just named, because he belongs to the folk, so to say.
Yes.
But in this, you know that Brahms once wrote on a card when he was asked for an, what do you call it?
His autograph.
Autograph. He wrote some bars of the Blue Danube and said, I'm sorry to say, not by Brahms.
Yes, I remember that story, I think he wrote it on Mrs. Strauss's program.
Mrs. Strauss's program. And I feel the same. I have a great love for this kind of music, and I felt the affinity with Vienna when I set foot on Vienna, even before, when I saw the trains go to Vienna. My heart was aching because I felt some
pull
affinity,
there, yeah.
Some pull in it. And when I came to Vienna, it was like coming home. In Berlin, when I went to my school, I had to take the train for the suburban train. And on the other side, I saw trains to Petersburg and trains to Rome and to Wien. And when I saw Wien, my heart ached. And there's something mysterious. When I came first time to Vienna, I was, let me see, it was in 1900. I was 98. I was 22 years old. I came and I knew my way. I knew the city, like in a dream,
Yes.
I knew my way, I knew everything. I felt at home at once. Yes.
Well, Doctor, as you approach your 80th birthday, in addition to your impressions of the past, what is your thought about the future?
I do not consider what's coming as a future. I love to go on learning. And I have still to write something. Perhaps I am allowed still to make music for some time. But whatever will come, I accept it very willingly. I have full patience and full willingness to accept what life still will give. And I go on learning. That's all.